thank you today, and we honor your presence, and Lord, we glorify you. Lord, I want to say publicly, I thank you for these people. Lord, I thank you for them. And Lord, I want to ask, you always do what I ask you to do, because I do it by faith, because I know you love us. And so God, I'm going to ask you to manifest a blessing in their life, something they didn't ask for, something they can't dream about. I ask you to blow their minds right now in Jesus' name. God, because I thank you, because they could have went somewhere else. They could have, you know, sold somewhere else. Lord God, they could have encouraged someone else, but Father God, but they came here. Lord, even this is their first time, second time, or third time, Lord God, let us all have all things in common. And I thank you, Father God, for their house will now suffer anything that is needed. There'll be no lack to come to their homes, their family, or to their health, their bodies. And Lord, we thank you right now for supernatural overflow. It's more than a plethora. It's hard to conceive. And Lord, we thank you for it right now in Jesus' name. So therefore, I acknowledge you in your presence, your power, and in the midst of this great congregation. This is your ability and not mine's. And this anointing shall be used to destroy yokes and move burdens, but the glory shall be given to you untouched in Jesus' name. And I thank you that the Spirit, Lord God, does rest upon me, for you anointed me to preach this gospel to the poor. You sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, to cover sight to the blind, and preach the acceptance of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You place in my mouth right now words of prosperity for your people to experience increase, and we believe in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So go ahead, get your Bibles in your hand or your mobile device. Lift them high, repeat after me. Say, this is my Bible. Say, it is my word of God. And it's the living word of God. And say, it brings life to me. Say, I can do what it says I can do. I can be who it says I can be. And I can have what it says I can have. And say, my life is better after I'm heard, spoken, and practice this word of God. And I say, devil, you are too late, because we are believers. Amen, amen, amen. This morning, we're going to talk again on the subject of reset the dynamite. Amen. Resetting the dynamite. You know, when dynamite goes off to explode, it's supposed to destroy that which is no longer needed or necessary or a hindrance. Amen. But we're talking about dynamite. We're talking about the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so if the dynamite does not go off, then we have to check. We have to reset it. Amen. Now, Wednesday, we talked about how, you know, your lights in your home, if you turn the light switch on, but the light doesn't come on, then you go check the light bulb. But if there's nothing wrong with the light bulb, then you have to go to the control panel. Amen. And sometimes you go to that control panel, you see that switch over there has a little play in it. It's a little loose. And so what you got to do, you got to switch, you got to reset it in order for the power to perform again. And I believe that in every service, there should be a performance of God's power. And we want to make sure that our switch is not loose or playful. We want to make sure we have reset the power. Amen. Because what's going to bring a change and an experience for people to believe in this day and time is demonstration of power. Demonstration of power. Amen. And I believe that the atmosphere is already ready and charged for a demonstration of power. Every time, everywhere Jesus went to preach, or Paul, whatever, or Peter, when they went to preach, power was demonstrated. I believe when we pray, power should be demonstrated. Something's supposed to happen. Suppose you went to work for a whole entire month and you didn't get paid. Man, you'd be cussing and fighting and protesting and coming up all kinds of stuff. You know, now I know, y'all say, well, I ain't gonna cuss, let them not pay. You be up there saying something you ain't got no business to be saying. You know, you got children in the home you got to take care of. And I say you would, but you probably feel like it. Or you might pay somebody else to do it. I don't know. But what I'm trying to get to is that it don't make no sense to go to a job and work and don't get no results. I don't get paid. What good is keep going to a church and then you still can't believe to receive? I truly believe that we're supposed to have results. We're supposed to have results. I don't believe that the Holy Spirit is in this earth so that we can have a good prayer time. Amen. We're supposed to have results. Somebody say results.
Results.
And one of the results we're doing through a prayer and power of the Holy Spirit, we call in the more young people. We call in musicians. We're calling in, you know, signs and wonders and miracles like never before. We call on in. Amen. Because people need to get healed. Amen. Because, you know, people say, well, we're talking about this, you know, coronavirus and everything, but is it a name? Yes, it is a name. But my Bible said that every name, anything that's named, is going to have to bow its knee to the name of Jesus. See, so don't let the world shape you and influence you to fear. Now, I'm not saying don't do the healthy and things you're supposed to do, but don't let them condition you to fear. Amen. Matter of fact, I mean, the virus was created to control the stock market, to move money around. And if you listen to the Holy Ghost, you should have invested in some tissues and some surgical masks and hand sanitizers and all that stuff. That's how they move money around. Okay? Now, it's so important that we understand this, that the power of the Holy Spirit keeps us, it protects us, and empowers us to do that what God has called us to do. Amen? And right now, you and I have the power, and we have the presence of the Holy Spirit. If you have the presence, you have the power. Amen. So that could be a performance. That could be a demonstration in any area of our life, every area of our life. Let's go over here to the book of Luke chapter 24. Well, Pastor Harvey, how you know that virus was created? Because he told me. Amen. And people are giving up on a lot of stuff. I had two people. One person, they want a business. They want a trip to Dubai. They are afraid to fly. Okay? They're afraid to fly. And they want a trip to Dubai, so they gave it to somebody else. They said, well, I'm afraid of the coronavirus. I said, now, don't you know people still flying in planes? Yeah. Everything is still moving forth and things are happening. You see how, and we can't be believers in fear. See, there might be darkness in Egypt, but there will always be light in Goshen. See, you got protection on your life. And if it's not for you to have or do a certain thing, you have a Noah on the inside that would tell you what to do and what not to do. All right. Amen. Now let's look at Luke 24. We'll look at verse 49. He says this, and Jesus, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. Notice that he's, I'm going to send him upon you. But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be what? Endued with power where? From on high. Now, it's important for us to understand this, that he says that, and behold, I send the promise of my Father, which is the Holy Spirit. He said, I'm sending him what, upon you. Amen. Not only he's going to be in us, but he's going to be what? Upon us. Amen. Somebody say, have him upon me. See, when he's upon you, then you can do something. Let me put it to you this way. When in the book of Genesis, when Adam was formed, God created Adam in his image. Amen. Now, so that means that Adam had the influence and the personality of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit rests upon Adam. The Holy Spirit clothed Adam. Amen. So that Adam could walk around and do things like God does. Amen. How could you be created in God's image and have no reflection or ability of that image? You know, you may have some children, some grandchildren that look like you, but guess what? They also act like you on the good side, amen? You know, when they act up, say, you acting like the people on the other side of your family. Watch it. and they take on traits and abilities. Adam had God's ability. He had God's spirit upon him. He was clothed in that. And the Bible said, and when Adam sinned, he was naked. Yeah. And we don't want to be the type of believers that walk around naked. Right. We want to be clothed upon. Endued means to be clothed upon. It means to be invested. It means to be empowered. Amen. So everywhere you go, you have this special ability upon you, watch us now, to function like Jesus functioned in the earth. Yeah. Notice when Jesus said, before I leave, he said, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. In other words, he said, I'm not going to leave you like an orphan. Yeah. Okay? So an orphan doesn't have a what? A father, right? So what the Holy Spirit does, the Holy Spirit, one of his main assignments is watching it to initiate and to activate us as sons of God. Yeah. Amen. That we are offspring of God. So we can operate on this planet just like Jesus. He said, listen, I'm not going to leave you without a comforter. And he's going to make sure that you walk on this planet the same way that I walk on this planet. So he said, the works that I do, you should do them also even greater. Yes. Amen. So so this is something we really have to, you have to take this word, you have to marinate this, you have to just keep looking at it, you got to keep asking God questions, because it's too powerful to leave on you two. Yeah. Amen. Matter of fact, you got to be the two. You got to be the tool that he uses, that he empower for demonstrations of his love upon this earth. Amen? Somebody say, I've been clothed. Let's go over here to the book of Romans, chapter 8. The book of Romans in chapter 8. And we're going to focus our attention on verse 14. When you have it, say amen. Romans 8, 14. He says that, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, he said, they are the who? The children of God. You see that? But see, we can't operate like the child of God or resemblance him without the Spirit influencing us. That word led don't mean that he just hold your hand and guide you around the store. It means to be influenced. And you cannot have influence if there's no time in fellowship. The less time there is in fellowship or participate in communication or communion or talking, the less there is, the less influence there is. You know, you tell your children, don't hang with so-and-so, because you hang with so-and-so, you're going to end up like them, because the more you hang with them, the more that influence get on. You begin to operate like that person. Yeah. He says, for you have not received the spirit of bondage again to what? To fear. But you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, well, Abba, Father. Then the spirit of adoption. So the Holy Spirit, his one of his main assignments is to bring us into sonship. Amen. He said the spirit itself, watch that, bear witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. This is his job, is to bear witness. So we supposed to act like our Father. Amen. We're supposed to act like Jesus. I'm not just talking about, you know, you don't smoke, you don't drink. We already know you're not supposed to do that. You know that'll kill you. Yeah. But he's talking about operating that power. Amen. When somebody's sick or they sneeze or whatever the case may be, we can prevent that. All right. Amen. Yeah. We can do things like Jesus did. So one of his main assignments, why this now, is to build us up in sonship. Yeah. And Wednesday night, we learned this, that, you know, that stuff has bounced all in my head. Let me watch it. Wednesday night we learned this, that when the madman of Gadara, when they saw Jesus, we said, we know who thou art. He said, thou art the Son of God. And so when you go somewhere, everything that's unclean should know who thou art. That you are a child of God. See, you can say, well, I'm a pastor, I'm a minister. And they say, well, that don't mean nothing if you don't know you're a son of God. You don't have no authority over us. Amen. See, it's the children of God who have the authority. And the Holy Spirit assignment is to empower us, watching us, to walk in that authority. We don't want to be, I just go to church, I go home, and, you know, and we support the ministry. We want to walk in sonship. We want to walk in power. Somebody say power. Somebody say reset the dynamite. And look at this now. He says that, and if children, verse 17, then heirs of God. His assignment is to bring us to our inheritance and join heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. He said, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. What glory he talking about? He talking about the manifestations. He's talking about the manifestation of who we are, doing that by the power of God, for the earnest expectation of the creature waiting for the manifestations of the, what? For the sons of God. The world is not waiting for preachers. They're not waiting for offering. The world itself, the dirt, the trees, the animals, the weather, all that, they're waiting for us to show up. All right. Amen. They're waiting for us to show up. Who are we? We are the sons of God. All that, he said, the moaning, the groaning, and the travail, when the sons of God, the children of God, are manifested, moaning and groaning and travail ceases when we manifest. The Bible said in the book of Psalms, chapter 82, he said, the whole earth is out of course. Go to Psalms 82. Watch this. Let's get into it. Hold your hand right here. Praise God. Psalms 82. I just don't want to preach and holler and all right. We're going to get into something here. Amen. Whew, Lord have mercy, Jesus. Psalms 82. And in verse 5, he says, they know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. He said, all the foundations of the earth are out of course. He said, I have said, you are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High. He said, we don't walk as children of God, being that we don't walk as children of God. He said, that's why the whole earth is out of course. It's offline. It's not operated, it's supposed to operate, because the sons of God are supposed to dictate the earth. Isn't that assignment that he gave to Adam? Yeah. When he blessed him, yeah. Have dominion and authority, replenish, subdue? Amen. So he's telling us this is what we're supposed to be doing. Amen. And this is the purpose and the power of the Holy Spirit. But he said, but watch it. He said, if you don't understand who you are, he said, you're going to die just like a mere man. And he wants us to walk on this planet as the sons of God, children of God. Amen. Some people say, I can't handle a son. What's the difference between a son and a child? Yeah. Oh, yeah. People say, well, you can't say you're a son of God, but I'm a child of God. But what's the difference? Amen. The difference is this, that you fail to accept the fullness of being loved by the Father. Amen. He don't love us halfway. Hey, watch this. He don't even love you less than he loves Jesus. The same way that he loved Jesus, the same way he loves you and I. Yeah. That got to be because he sent him to die for us. Yeah. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. If he didn't really love us, why would he send his son? Right, if he didn't see, by him sending his son so that he loved us just like he loved him, it is equal. Yeah. And he did not send an angel. He didn't send a cousin. He sent a son. So if you sow a son, if you sow a child, you watch the ends of the earth, you're going to get more children. Amen. That's because he loved us the same. Yeah. When a seed, apple seed is sown, those apples come, all those apples are the same. Yeah. Amen. They come off the same tree. Tell you, they say we come off the same tree. All right. Amen. Now watch this. Now let's go back to Romans, where we were in Romans 8. Romans 8. And he says in verse 20, he said, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who is subject to same in hope, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation is groaning and travailed in pain together until now. Not on the earth, but we too. And what we know we're talking about, there's areas in your life where you and I will moan and groan and travail until we manifest. Until we manifest. See, we're always going to have some problems or some situations or troubles or trials or tribulation in life that we cannot handle unless, watch now, we walk as children of God. The solution is already in your DNA. It's in your identity. Yeah, yeah. Amen. And once you and I walk into our identity, everything that you've been travailing over, everything you've been groaning about, he said you could conquer. It will cease as you manifest. Yeah. But how are we going to manifest? By the Spirit of the living God. He bears witness that we are children of the Most High God. We're children of him. Amen. It's more than, you know, I'm going to let you stand in line. I'm going to let you have my place in line. Why? Because I'm a child of God. He said, no, you understand. It's more than that, than being just a nice individual. Sinners can be nice. A sinner can open the door for somebody. Sinners can buy Girl Scout cookies. Amen. But sinners can't raise the dead. Sinners can't cast out devils. Right. Sinners can't heal the sick. Right. Come on now, sinners can't stop and control storms. Right. Are you see, that's the difference. Being kind and nice doesn't equal to being a child of God. Right. Amen. Being a child of God means you walk in dominion. Now watch that. Jesus was the last Adam. Why? When he died on Calvary's cross, he showed that all of us could be living in that last Adam. In other words, this thing is settled. We all can now walk in that same glory. That same anointing. Man, you're so greased up in that anointing. Every time you go, you can't even go into the front of your store because you sit on, you're going to leave a stain there. Amen. Because you're so oiled up with God's power. Amen. And sometimes you can feel it. You can sense it while you're in church. That surging power. It's bear witnessing on inside of you that you are now capable. to overcome any issue in your life and to walk in wisdom and revelation and understanding. Because watch this, that power also will tell you, drink more water. Amen. That power will tell you, stay away from Burger King. Mm-hmm. Stay away from Popeyes. Because see, in this place, right, a lot of you get healed, and then you relapse on the healing through the way you eat. Because you eat too bad. I'm looking right. I ain't scared of y'all. I'm up here. I ain't afraid. There's some doors right over there. I can run right out there. I'm telling you. You eat wrong, man. You got to eat healthy. That's what the wealth is for. Amen. You got to stop being stingy when it comes to your temple. Amen. You got to take care of yourself. Tell them to say, take care of yourself. Say, drink plenty of water. Say, eat vegetables. And eat fruit. That's what a lot of people here don't eat. Don't raise your hand. How many you eat vegetables and fruit? You know it yourself. See, y'all raise it. Y'all want to embarrass it. I eat it. Let you know I'm righteous. Amen. I'm sanctified. Amen. I'm with you, Pastor. But God put vegetables and fruits on this planet to maintain our health. Well, I don't like it. Do you like taking Tylenol? That Tylenol ain't gummy bears. You do know it's not candy, right? Do you like taking high blood pressure medicine, the cholesterol for cholesterol? You don't like taking it, like it's not, I don't have a taste to it. And this fruits and vegetables is for your organs. Yeah. It's for your organs. Yeah. Now I'm teaching health up here. but a lot of the pain and the frustration in your life right now is from your eating habits. And the Holy Spirit will tell you, no, don't eat that. Put that pizza down. You had three this week, put it down. Let's move on. Yeah, a lot of people still going to try to go to corral after service, though, but that's okay. Amen. Be so many cars and go to corral. I said, is this the promised land? Well, everybody there. Everybody has congregated at the Golden Corral. Lord, help me move on. Ephesians 1. Get that magnesium in your body. Praise the Lord. Look at this now. We're just going to take care of ourselves because we're going to the next level. Amen. It's like this. Let me tell you something about your organs. Can I tell you something about your organs? Your organs is the most valuable portion of your body. It's most valuable. You know, they'll let you lose your mind before you lose your organs. Your brain, rather. Let your brain go. We want your organs. It is a big business. Have you noticed that when they get into organ trades, that the organs basically come from people who are overseas? They kidnap them, they fence them up, they kill them just like animals. They take the organs. You know why? Because they don't have all that stuff in their food like we have in our food. So the people over here who have all the preservatives and stuff in their food are the ones who need the organs. So those who have a lot of money, they pay for to buy organs. So they got places set up, warehouses, where they got kidney, livers, and all that stuff up there for those who can afford it. But they get it from the people who don't live in the United States. Yeah. All right. Uh-huh. Because their organs are cleaner. All right. Yeah. You got to take care of your organs. If you take care of your organs, everything will realign itself. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. When the last time you had a colon cleanse? You got to clean your organ, your colon, your liver, and your kidney. If you have trouble drinking or smoking, detox. Because it's just the remnants and the residue on the inside is demanding the thirst and the hunger for the thing. You get that out, you're straight from that. Right. Amen. Just take care of yourself. You. We need you around. Yeah. Amen. Don't kill yourself and want us to raise you up. Don't do that. Take care of yourself. Tell your neighbor, say, you are important. Let's move on. Ephesians 1. Boy. Now, how I'm going to flip over here from all the way from there, from organs to the promise of the Spirit. That's a long stretch, man. That's a long stretch. Okay. All right. Let's look at how we're going to do this, Lord. Okay. Let's go over here. Let's look at verse 17. Now, let's look at verse 13. He said, "In whom ye also trusted after you have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after you believe, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of what? A promise." You see that? We were sealed with him. He says, "Which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of what? His glory." Now, he's the Spirit of promise. Somebody say the Spirit of promise. His assignment is to bring to pass everything that God had the prophets of old to prophesy, everything that was in the Old Testament under the covenant. That's his job, to bring all that to pass. Amen. And so it's important for us to understand his purpose and his assignment. Let's go over here to chapter 2. Got to make up for talking about the organs and everything. Let's go to chapter 2, verse 18. It said, "For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father." So by watching that, through him, he is saying, not this, Paul wasn't talking to him and the people. He's talking about Jesus and us. We have access to the Father by the Spirit. Right now, you and I have access to the Father by the Spirit. Amen. Even if you don't feel like you're there, you are there because you have access by the Father, by the Spirit, to the Father. Amen. Somebody say, "I have access." Now you have that interest by his Spirit. And verse 19 says this. He says that, "But now therefore we are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the who? Of the household of God." He makes us fellow citizens. We have citizen rights to that God-given power. We have rights to it. We have rights to all the promises of God. See, a lot of times when you pray, when you believe in God, don't you feel like sometimes you know, this is just your assignment? But see, when you pray, it's not just your prayer standing alone. Angels getting involved, the Holy Spirit getting involved, and Jesus sitting there saying, "Amen." The Father is saying, "Okay." You follow what I'm saying? See, don't ever think that when you're praying that your prayers to be answered rest on you alone. When you call a thing that be not as though they were, angels now are employed. They're moving. And Jesus said they have a right to it. Amen. And the Father and the Son are in agreement. This is how, it's just like when you go to apply for a home, for a loan or whatever, it doesn't go on a piece of paper and go on the file. It goes to a certain person, another person, then it goes through underwriting. It goes through all these different processes, et cetera, et cetera. That's why I got all the fees on it, because so many people got to look at it. So many people are involved with it. When you pray, you are not praying in yourself, by yourself alone. God has given us a whole corporation of divine angels and agents to help us, to process, to assist, and to make sure that it comes on the scene. But if you don't have that in your understanding, then there's no faith when you pray. You're not believing to receive when you pray. Amen. Because angels, the Holy Spirit, all of them are involved when you're praying for your children. So watch this now. You may be praying for your child and you see nothing different. You say, "But it's in the underwriting department right now." And they make sure your children are protected, your grandchildren, all, et cetera, et cetera. They do all that to the full manifestations of it. So when you pray for your family, your children, they may still be going through some things, but watch them. But by your covenant that you have with God and the power of the Holy Ghost protects them until the full manifestations. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Tell your name, say, "Wait on God." Okay, now look at this now. Let's look at the book of Proverbs, chapter 20, verse 27. Proverbs 20, 27. He says that The spirit of man is the counter of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. The spirit of man. So there's a spirit in man, and the counter of the Lord is the spirit of the man. Watch this now. So I want you to bring this now to your attention. The body connects us to the physical senses. Amen. The body connects us to the physical, the tangible. The soul connects us to the senses and the intellects. But the Spirit of God, the Spirit connects us to God. Lord. Amen. And you and I are a spirit possessing a soul living in a body. Amen. Our spirit connects us to God. Uh-huh. That's how we stay in tune and fellowship with God through our spirit. Yeah. Amen. Now, let's look over here at Job chapter 32. Let's look at verse 8. He says this. He said, but there is a spirit in man. And then he said, and the inspiration of the Almighty giving him understanding. Yeah. Now, so we see the connection, how God connects with us by a spirit that is in us, which is we are a spirit being. Amen. And the inspiration, the spiritual part that he placed in us to give us understanding. So no matter what you're dealing with in life right now, God will inspire you. The Almighty will inspire you for the understanding that you need. You will never be in obscurity. You'll never be in darkness. You'll never be in a point that you know not what to do because you understand that I am a spirit. Live, possessing a soul, living a body. And God, by the inspiration of the Almighty, he gives me understanding. Amen. You can't say, well, I'm not good with math. Well, you say you're not good with math, what you're trying to say to God is not good with math. Because he'll give you understanding with the math. Come on, talk to me now. He'll give you understanding with the math. In any area where you do not have understanding in the natural, he'll give you understanding in the spirit for it. Amen. He'll give you understanding. Nobody dreamed up something on their own. Nobody solves an issue or problem on their own. The Spirit of God gives you understanding to solve the problem. So any problem that you have solved, let me tell you something, you ain't that smart. I hate to bust your bubble, but they want you. You have a genius on the inside of you. Amen. But you got to keep that power working. Somebody said, keep the power working. Amen. Look at this now. So watch this now. Now, this is so important. Now, let's look at this now. Even for Satan to get something done, notice he can't get nothing done just because he's on the earth. He got to take his spirit and he got to get it in a man or a person. He had to influence someone. He had to demonically inspire someone in order to have legal access to get something demonstrated or manifested. And he knows that. That's why Jesus said what? Casting out devils. Amen. Casting out devils and unclean spirits. You cast them out of what? Out of bodies, out of people. Because if you cast them out of people, that's less what's manifestations of the devil. You got to get that foul spirit out of the body in order to stop the performance. Watch this now. Now on the other side, you got to have the Holy Spirit on the inside of you, watch it now, to get the performance of God. Because now Jesus is sitting in heaven, we are on the earth, but his spirit is in us. Because he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, I will even be with you to the end of the earth. Yeah. How he do that? By his spirit. Yeah. So therefore, Jesus said, now I can operate through you and with you. Yeah. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. So as he is, so are we now in this world. Because he operates through us by his spirit. And one thing the devil cannot handle is a person who knows they are possessed with the Holy Spirit. Amen. That he takes over every area of our lives. He the one who helps you, watch us now, when you feel like acting like you got the Negro virus. You know, when you feel, everybody see that virus come through sometime. It's easily caught to you, know what I'm saying? And you want to act like that, he the one who constrains you. from doing a thing that you want to do according to that virus. He's the one say, he's the one who empowers you to love. And some of you right now, you're fascinated right now. How did I was able to forgive that person? How after what they did to me, that was the power. You hit the switch. And it destroyed, watch now, the effects of what they did to you. So you can rise up even though you may have been, you know, somebody probably deprived you or did something wrong to your finances or to your family. But you can get over that because you got power to destroy that. Yeah. And still walk in your destiny. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. You got to hit the switch. You got to reset it. All right. You follow what I'm saying? You have to reset the switch. Good. And walk in that power because he's the one who gives you comfort. Good. He's the one who gave you dominion. He's the one who gives you authority and Washington and promotion. Yeah. Amen. Let's go to the next level. So the inspiration of the Almighty gives us understanding. That's why in 2 Timothy chapter 3:16, he said, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. God breathed. Yeah. Then he says we have the same spirit of faith according as it is written. Amen. So the Holy Spirit's job, his assignment, is to bring to pass the word of God that is in this Bible, every promise, by you and I cooperating with him. Yeah. He's not going to do it by himself, because the Bible tells me that the Holy Spirit was hovering over the face of the earth. Yeah. And he will keep on hovering until he got a word. Yeah. Amen. We don't just want him hovering, we want him demonstrating. Yeah. Amen, somebody. Come on, talk to me now. The Bible says in Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 6, God said, what I'm going to do is not by might, it's not by power. He said, but be by my spirit. So anything that needs to be done, the only way it's going to get done is by his spirit. Yeah. Isn't that something? Because all things are done by his spirit. It's not done by human strength or ability. It's done by his spirit. So that takes the limits off our lives. Amen. Because it could be demonstrated by his spirit. You'll be wealthy by his spirit. You'll be healthy and whole, what? By his spirit. Everything that is done, that according to the word of God, will be performed and manifested, what? By his spirit. And we have his spirit on us and in us. Yeah. Amen. It's amazing. You know, he can bring something to your remembrance, and he can draw pictures, and he can give you an illustration, a revelation. He is fascinating. He is an awesome person, man. I mean, the Holy Spirit, he is so awesome. And we got to take him out of the Pentecostal box. Yeah. Amen. And let him be the leader and the commander of our lives. Even when we mess up, when we sin, and we want to condemn ourselves. He said, come on. He said, get over it. The blood took care of that. He said, nobody feels so bad. I'm not worried. He said, we know you ain't worried, but God made you worried. He said, bad. Well, you still a child of God. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Amen, somebody. Have your children ever did anything wrong? Yeah. And I got to do this, but they ain't going to be the last time they did it if they ever did anything. Right. But they still your child. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. You can't change that. That is still your child. And God said, listen, don't condemn yourself. He said, because you still my child. He said, I already don't fix it. I took care of that. Yeah. He said, I sent my son on Calvary's cross to bleed, to shed his blood for you. For mission all sins, to forgive you from all sins. Amen. Suppose that was only a one-time shot. All right. Or suppose that Jesus now, no, he said, I come to die for your sin for the day. He'll be coming to earth every day. All right. Yeah. Every second. Are you following? See, he took care of all of it. Yeah. And if you surely, truly appreciate it, watch this now, you don't have to worry about falling back into it. But if you do fall back into it, he said, I can take care of it. I still cleanse you because that blood is still cleansing blood. Amen. God didn't put that blood in a bottle and put it up in the refrigerator somewhere. It's still working. God, it's still cleansing. Amen. It is still cleansing right now, that blood. Amen. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Look at this now. Look at the book of Ephesians chapter 3. Wow, Jesus, thank you, Lord God. The book of Ephesians chapter 3. That's why praying in the Holy Ghost is so vital. Because the Bible said in the book of Jude, he said that it does what? It builds up your what? Your most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Praying in the Holy Ghost. Because see, if you don't pray in the Holy Ghost, build up your most holy faith, you talk yourself out of what God is trying to lead you into. And some say, no, not me. I just want to sit in the background. Go, come on, man. Let's just say you're afraid. That ain't being humble. Listen to me, child of God. Humble means this. I align myself with God. I submit to what God wants to do in my life. Amen. I submit to that. When they were talking about going to Egypt, I said, oh, no. I was thinking about the movie, the mummy. I'm thinking about plagues and everything. I heard God whisper and say, I send you to Egypt. I said, okay, yes, I'll do it. Lord. Amen. He's gonna take care of the provisions and all that stuff by his spirit. I got to stay in harmony with him. I got to speak what he speaks in order for the spirit of God to perform. All Amen. Right. Yeah. Okay, what? Look at this now. The book of Ephesians chapter 3. Yes, sir. He says that in verse 16. He says that he will grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by what? His spirit in our what? Our inner man. That's our spirit man. Watch this now. So if his spirit strengthened our spirit with might, that means power. Amen. That means power, performance, dunamis, like dynamite. He says that be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. Then he goes to verse 17, that. You see that? He said, that Christ may dwell. In other words, he says, if his spirit strengthens us with might, he said, that's why and how that Christ will dwell in our hearts by faith. Then he said, and that ye. See that? That ye, being rooted and grounded in love. Then he said, may. He gives you permission. This is may here means divine permission. You may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. Then he says, and to know. But all of this coming from his spirit strengthens us in our inner man. Yeah. And to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. Watch it, the Holy Ghost doing that. That you might be filled with all the fullness of God. The Holy Ghost is doing that. Then he says, now unto him who is God. That is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think according to the what? But where that power come from? The power is coming from the might. Where the might come from? From the Holy Spirit. So the more we allow him to strengthen what's might on the inside, we arrive to the place called now. Because now all of our asking and all our thinking is lined up with the Holy Spirit that is strengthening us with might in our inner man. So therefore, now he can perform based on the word of God. That's why I'm saying that we can talk ourselves out of what God is trying to lead ourselves into. Amen. All right, watch it. This is where we're going to close, y'all. Now, in the book of Genesis, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit hovered over the face of the earth. And when God spoke the word of God, he performed the word of God. Yeah. Amen. He performed the word of God. Yeah. And then in the book of Luke, when Jesus at about to be baptized, his ministry didn't begin until the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. Then he went off into the next chapter and performed the first miracle, turning water into wine. Because he had the power on him to demonstrate. Yeah. Amen. Then he came across a young lady, by the name of Mary. And Mary is now, she has a visitation by an angel. And the angel said, Hail Mary, thou highly favored. And Mary said, what is the salutation? What is the cause of this? And he was talking about you're going to bring forth a child. And Mary said, well, how is this thing going to be? He said, the Holy Ghost. He's going to hover over you. And know what Mary said? So be it. Mary could have talked herself out of what God was trying to bring her into. And she would say the wrong thing, the Holy Spirit wouldn't be able to perform. Because he can only perform the promise. He can only perform that what God wants done. So never say you can't do something. Never said, how shall this thing be that I'm going to raise this child as being a single parent? How shall this thing be that I'm going to get out of this debt and I'm going to get this house with this low beacon score that I have and I'm behind on taxes and I owe everybody, I even owe myself some money, can't pay myself back. He said, how should this thing be? How's it going to be? By you lining up your words with God's words, because you got the Holy Spirit hovering over you, ready to perform God's promise pertaining to you. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. This is so vital. Do not speak contrary. He said, if you speak contrary, the Holy Spirit said, you grieve me. I can't do nothing. Yeah. See, when you talk crazy, I can't do nothing. I got to sit there and watch you and wait till you get yourself back together. He said, go ahead, reset the dynamite. He said, come on, start speaking some powerful things so that I can perform miracles in your life. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I said, you look at something. Don't keep looking at it. He said, look into the word. Because yeah, you look to the word, I got power to change what you saw over there. That's right. Amen. He's got power to change that. Yeah. But we have to allow him to have our speaking and our thinking. Yeah. And knowing that I'm a powerful being because I got the Holy Spirit in me and I got him on me. Amen, somebody. Got a moment. How many of you have them on you today? You need them on you to be a parent. You need them on you to be whoever you need to be in this earth. You need him on you. You don't have him on you, you're in bad shape. Right. Amen. Yeah, we'll reset the power today. Yeah. Come on, let's stand on our feet. Let's give God a powerful praise. Amen. Come on, let's thank the Lord. Amen.
Thank you for tuning in to the Increase International Ministries broadcast today. We pray that the Word of God has richly blessed and transformed your life. To know more about us, you may visit our website at increaseinternationalministries.com or connect with us on Facebook at Increase INT Ministries or contact us by phone at 804-658-4896. Remember, wherever you go, may increase and favor flow.
Keep him in your thinking. Keep him in your thinking. Keep him in your thinking. I could have talked.